A very good morning to you all. Today is 24th June 2020. Today in this video, we'll be discussing the articles of the Hindu editorial page. The first article is regarding the virus of arbitrary power, the worrisome today and whimsical curtailment of liberty and a brazen partnership. This is regarding the derail of the bail to pregnant student activist. The second article focuses upon the sharp end of military power, that is the importance of air power along the line of actual control and the defensive and offensive strategies and IAF advantage. Third article focuses upon the Udhampur Shankar murder case, the High Court verdict in a caste murder case and a setback push for protecting freedom of martial's choice. The final article is regarding H-1B visa halt. There's no sure way for preventing isolated terror attacks that require little planning. Before I begin, I request to subscribe to my channel. I am Prashant. Let's get started. This is the cartoon of the day, which shows that both India and China having a dispute regarding the Galwan Valley, claiming that this is our territory. And to the media, they are saying that we are trying our best for disengagement. The first article is regarding the arrest the virus of arbitrary power. In the early days of lockdown, when COVID-19 cases began to rise, we witnessed the second virus spreading equally rapidly in the country, the virus of communalism. But there is a third virus which will also spoke. A virus eating into and severely corroding our democratic structure, the virus of arbitrary power. There is no better evidence of this than the denial of bail to pregnant student activists arrested for creating a disorder of an unprecedented scale when she appeared to have all done or was actively participating in many others in protest against the Citizenship Amendment Act in 2019 propaganda proposed by the government. The tyranny and slavery. This arbitrary use of power implied by the absence or selective use of law is deeply troublesome, or more so when excited or exercised by a democratically elected government. A frequent arbitrariness in a political domain leads to tyranny, quite like when persistently present in a social sphere, it leads to slavery. But what, one might ask, is connection between the arbitrariness and a loss of freedoms? Individuals, communities or citizens cannot function freely without a stable set of expectations. By stabilizing expectations, laws enable significant freedoms even as they restrict some others. To take one example, once it is widely known that the legally restricted to driving only to the left. When I drove with a greater freedom, knowing that the headlong collision is unlikely. The regulations of the speed of travel and calculation of time to get from home to office. This helps me to schedule work for the day and coordinate with others who likewise make their own schedules. By jointly accomplishing our goals, we enhance our freedom. A loss enable our actions and interactions to become broadly predictable. However, and very basic feature of arbitrariness, one that produces much greater harm, is to be at the mercy of the whim or fancy of something else, especially the powerful. A return to the traffic example, suppose that two vehicles stop at the traffic light, but just beyond the zebra crossing, the policeman embodying the entire might of the state issues a ticket or a challenge to one but not the other. Worse, instead of filing or fining the violators, he seizes the driving license of a careful driver who had stopped at a good meter behind the crossing merely because he dislikes the make of his car. Surely this arbitrary implementation of the law is grossly unjust. This shows that the minute aspect of daily life, traveling to work, can be dependent upon the arbitrary opinion of someone else. When power is exercised arbitrarily by the state, a person is made to act not in accordance with a legitimate general rule but at the pleasure of a state's official. The most extreme example is that the political enslavement, when an entire people were colonized subject to the will of colonizers with a loss good or bad. This is equally true of an arbitrary exercise of social power, for instance under the social slavery. A slavery must comply with any, just any whimsical order of his master. Since the master owns him, the master is legally permitted to do just about anything which is slave. The slave breathes at his pleasure, sits or stands at his pleasure, eats, works, sleeps at his pleasure. Slaves can be awakened and asked to work in the field at unearthly hour of the night. If the master so desires, they are never sure of what to expect from the master. One moment objections or the objects of affection or charity, at the very next they are treated with utter disdain, sold, even killed. After all, the master can dispose his priority or property at will. Such arbitrary power was routinely exercised at the patriarch and the family and continues even today. Likewise, unbridled capitalism is marked by the absence of law to regulate the labor. Works can be hired or fired at the will of employer and no fixed hours of the work exist. Unregulated wage labor work pretty much like a slavery. Are not domestic workers still treated in many homes like slaves? The emergency and now, these examples strengthen my point about an inverse relation between the arbitrary political power and freedom. In dictatorship, entire populations are subject to the whim of a supreme leader or a tiny elite who did not fear the midnight knock in the regimes of Hitler and Stalin. While the devastation they caused is a well chronicled, similar tyrannies abound in our world too. Even democracies contain authoritarian spaces within them where the law can be used to continuously harass opponents. Anyone who had lived through the emergency knows the opposition leaders were thrown in jail or a false charge of conspiracy against the state, and thereafter a small crack unit began to arbitrarily control the activity of anyone politically significantly. Surely that the experience should have sufficed to make us all realize the supreme value of freedom of arbitrary rule. However, with the number of first information reports, that is FIRs, being filed at the behest of random persons or unsubstantiated complaints and a little explanations, largely uncontested by the silent political oppositions, one begins to wonder if we are headed that the unlawful or awful direction once again. Appending rights. Consider that the arrest of activists. Article 21 of Constitution gives every citizen of the right of basic liberty and security. No one can be deprived of liberty held without properly following the procedures prescribed by the law. Article 22 requires that anyone arrested and detained must be informed of the ground for such an arrest and must be brought before the competent legal authority within the prescribed time frame. Legal scholars have rightly pointed out that the best interpretation of this article requires that the grounds of arrest and detention must be reasonable. The grounds of preventive detention, to be used in a very rare case, must likewise assume that the suspicion of offense is well grounded based on the available evidence on relevant information that satisfies any objective observer and not on malicious allegations. But reality seems to confirm what every and other Indian movies have shown about the police acting on the caprice of ruling leader and the law being used to harass citizens. Is suspicion always supported by the available facts? Is the offender really a threat to internal security or merely present at the scene of the crime? Whatever the facts of the case, was the offense committed by the pregnant student activist so grave that bail could not be granted until yesterday on her fourth attempt? If ordinary persons could smell the arbitrariness here, why could not the sessions judge? Anyone who fill our coronavirus infested jails with what are largely political prisoners, when other countries are releasing even non-political inmates, minimum lockup during lockdown should be political slogan in our catastrophic times. Arbitrary curtailment of liberty existed under the previous state and central governments. This is deplorable, yet what is worrisome today is its frequency and a brazen partisanship. We should remind ourselves that the participants in an anti-corrupt movement of 2011 to 2012 were not thrown in jail, nor was the media muzzled when it went after the central government of a day. Why are the political activists and journalists charged, cheated today for simply doing their job? The emergency, whose anniversary falls to tomorrow, was the meant to be watershed in the life of Indian democracy, a brief critical phase when the Indian political system could have gone either the way of authoritarian rule or mature as a democracy. By restoring faith in democracy, India appeared to have passed one of its crucial tests and firmly take the second route. But are we on the verge of giving up the gains from the chastening experience? Has the struggle against the suspension of democracy been in vain? Have a small section of victims now become preparators? The question arises, and regarding this arrest of virus arbitrary, what is worrisome today is a whimsical curtailment and a brazen partisanship. Regarding the denial of bail to pregnant student activists who had filed a case against the Citizenship Amendment Act, in her fourth attempt she had given the bail. Second article is regarding the military power. In 1962, an uninformed political leader, dominant army brass and a diffident air force leadership ensured that a reasonably potent offensive element of Indian Air Force, that is IAF, watched from the sidelines of People's Liberation Army, that is PLA, rolled into Ladakh and down the Thela Pass in Bomdila. Played by the assessments of British operation research expert Patrick Blacklett and the US ambassador to New Delhi, John Kenneth, and then the Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru, or balked at the idea of using the Indian Air Force to stem the Chinese tide. The Indian Air Force fighter pilots posted at the air bases that could not impact the operations in Ladakh and the Tawang sector. Recall that they were battle ready and waited for a call to action that never came. Defensive and offensive strategies. Fast forward to the winter of 1986 and the summer of 1987. Following the establishment of the camp at Wangdong grazing grounds at Thumdrung Chu Valley, that is the northwest of Tawang, and in the same area where Indian forces were overwhelmed in 1962. The trio, that is General Krishnaswamy Sundararaji, the Lieutenant General Narahari and a Major General J.M. Singh, put together a logistically viable envelopment strategy that spooked the Chinese with numbers, firepower and aggression without needless confrontation. An important element of this strategy was the use of helicopters and transport aircraft to facilitate and sustain the deployment. That was not at all. They even deployed an offensive strategy to take the battle to the lee, the forward most of PLA base sector. There were also close coordinations between the four corps in Tejpur, and the fighters based close by and training was stepped up in the valley of supportive offensive operations if required. In an interview with an author, Major General J.M. Singh was emphatic that air power held the key in operations in the Tibetan Plateau. He also argued, "We must have been capability to gain and maintain the favorable situation or air situation for the limited period of time and carry out interdiction to back shallow multi-pronged thrust across the road less terrain to outflank the Chinese buildup that will be take place on the existing road and rail networks." The IAF's advantage. On June 15, 2020, there was a violent clash at patrolling point 14 in Galwan. The ground situation across the entire line of actual control is largely one parity and four tangible gains or a tactical advantage are to be gained on the ground of Indian army needs a numerically superiority of at least 5-1. Therefore, if there is any asymmetric advantage to be gained, it is a power that will prove to be decisive in depleting the PLA's combat potential before it is applied along the line of actual control. By all the recent operations assessments, including one by the Harvard Kennedy School, the IAF currently enjoys both qualitative or qualitative advantage over the People's Liberation Army Air Force, that is PLAAF, across the line of actual control. Its fighters' fleet of fourth generation aircraft are superior in almost every respect to the PLAAF or J-11S or Su-30 MKS. Though the IAF has also made operational bases that PLAAF close to LAC, there is a reasonable redundancy and the survivability to withstand an initial attack of the IAS by PLA rocket force. There's also, however, these two areas of concern. The first is a strong ground-based air defense networking strung up by the PLAAF in a Tibet comprising of S-300 or S-400 or HQ-9 systems that the IAF will have to contest during its offensive operations. The second is the advantage of PLAAF has in a long-range air-delivered cruise missiles from the bomber, as compared to that of IAF. Su-30 MKI has been cleared to carry the BrahMos land attack cruise missile with around a range of 300 kilometers in the targets of Akasi, Chin and Tibet. The other area significantly advantage enjoyed by the IAF is the aerial mobility department, where IAF transports some of its fleets as a proficient in diverse roles as the best forces in the world. The importance of the air. Unless there is a vision and an acceptance of the importance of air power in what has been till now a significantly land-centric operational philosophy across the line of actual control, there is a clear and a present danger. In the next decade or so, the IAF will lose its competitive advantage over the PLAAF, as the latter has invested heavily in modernization and continuing to do so. On the other hand, with the deep budgetary cuts and likelihood of slowing down the induction of cutting-edge platforms and weapon systems, the choice is not about what IAF want to be the country's need in prevailing complex security environment. Air power represents the sharp end of contemporary military power. We all need to ensure that waters should not get blunt. This is regarding the sharp end of military power. Unless there is a vision and acceptance of the importance of air along the line of actual control, defensive and offensive strategies. The next article is on Shankar murder case in Udhampur. There is an understandable disbelief and a shock over the Madras High Court's judgment acquitting a man found guilty of ordering a heinous murder of Dalit youth married to his daughter. With the lower court, after the expeditious trials, have awarded the death sentence to B. Chinnaswamy in the sensational Udhampur Shankar murder case, the High Court has ruled that no conspiracy have been proved. It is intended disappointing that the emblematic case of murder case against a member of Supreme Court in the name of preserving the honor of dominant caste had been reduced to a narrative without an author. None other than the five hurlings unknown to the victim have been found guilty. Their death sentence have been commuted to the life sentence without a remission for 25 years. V. Shankar have succumbed to as many as 33 injuries inflicted under the gaze of CCTV camera at the busy marketplace at Udhampur town in Tamil Nadu in March 2016. The assailants grievously attacked his wife Kausalya, Chinnaswamy's daughter. Fortunately, she survived, and her courageous deposition against her parents and fellow members of the dominant Hewar community led to the trial court sentencing her father and five assailants to death. The verdict was a shot in the arm of progressive sections concerned about the rising trend in the murders and attacks related to caste pride. The exoneration of Kausalya's family impedes the social agenda of protecting the freedom of women to make martial choices. The failure to prove the conspiracy charge reflects the poorly on the investigation and prosecution. The main question that arises is who had sent the assailants to eliminate the couple? If not Kausalya's parents, it is indeed true that the conspiracy ought to be proved through an unbroken chain of circumstances, and the strong suspicion cannot take place a proof. However, it is unfortunate that the court treated a peaceful parting of the way in a family soon after the temple wedding in 2015, when Kausalya gave a written statement before the police that her parents did not interfere with her martial life, and her father's complaint that Shankar had abducted her was closed as evidence that her father could not have plotted to attack them. It is not beyond human nature to suppress one's anger in public and strike at a more opportune time. It is possible that to say the court could have taken the different views of the call records that showed Chinnaswamy being in contact with the assailants and withdrawing money close to the crime. Despite some flaws in its case, the prosecution has expected to appeal against the verdict. It will be in the society's interest that Supreme Court gets to examine the full dimensions of this horrific crime. Regarding the Udhampulai Shankar's murder case, the High Court verdict in case of murder. The next article is on H-1B visa halt. The White House had made a proclamation restricting the issuance of non-migrant work visas across the board, purposely to clamp down the American jobs going to foreign workers, a consistent policy priority of the Donald Trump administration. And the board brush in order to include the H-1B visa for skilled workers, which is widely gone by Indian nationals, the H-2B visa issued the seasonal workers of the landscaping and hospitality industry. The L-1A visa of intercompany transfers and J-1 visa for the students to work study summer programs. It will also impact the H-4 visa dependents and H-1B visa holders. The proclamation will enter into the force on June 24th and be applicable until the end of the calendar year, which notably includes the November 3rd presidential elections. It is intended as to follow on order reducing the number of foreigners entering the US, and it comes back to the 60-day halt of legal migration that began on April 23rd. While a broad swath of workers is likely to be affected by the latest pause in the visa processing, the latest restrictions will not apply to the visa holders who are already within the US or those who are outside it and have already been issued valid visas. The reasons offered by the White House is that ongoing of COVID-19 pandemic has significantly disrupted American livelihoods to the extent that the overall employment rate in the country nearly quadrupled between February to May 2020 to around 13.3%. There's a little doubt that the policies of the Trump White House are likely to conflict the border or broader requirements of the 2020 presidential campaign, or one to which the sharp focus on America first, or in the case that need to project aggressive actions against American jobs alleging or being lost to the foreign workers. The week's proclamation offered data to bolster that claim, noting that the February and April, more than 20 million US workers lost their job in key industries where employers are currently requesting H-1B and L workers to fill positions. It is also observed that a similar or higher number could be found in the other listed visa categories. However, Mr. Trump may be finding that the blowback to American corporations, the employers of millions of non-immigration foreign workers in a speedy and salvage. Already, Google CEO Sundar Pichai has responded by tweeting, "Immigration had contributed immensely to America's economic successes, making it global leader in tech and also Google the company it is today. Disappointed by today's proclamation, we will continue to stand with the immigrants and works to expand opportunities for all." If more captions of Fortune 500 companies strike this note of disappointment and a lobby quietly behind closed doors to boost the prospects of Mr. Trump's arrival in November election, the former Democratic Vice President Joe Biden, that might be the straw that breaks the back of Trump campaign juggernaut. This is regarding the downing of the shutters on H-1B visa halts. That's the end of the article discussion. This is my Facebook page and you can follow me on Insta, Wi-Fi says Study Karo. I have given the description link so that you can just click that link and follow. And please do subscribe if you are new to my channel for further updates. Thanks for joining me. Have a great day.